Are you out to your coworkers?
I know they tend to put a lot more social pressure on Japanese people than like foreign workers.
If you're gay, queer, trans, and then if you want to like feel safer, I would say, then...
I wouldn't say it's difficult because Japanese people are very kind, or they don't attack you like in Germany, they would attack.
They look okay, come up a little bit so my face doesn't look that big.
Here, I can make my face like this. Does that make you feel better?
Hi, Tokyo Tops! Today we are outside, we are at a dance studio at the moment because our friend Polaris is hosting a cabaret show. Not a cabaret show, a drag show.
So Polaris runs a group called Queens for a Cause. They do various like performances and then they donate money that they raise to specific causes. So the show has various performers from the LGBTQ+ community, and we thought it'd be a great opportunity to come down and interview them, as we don't actually have a lot of various voices on our channel. So let's go check out their rehearsal and ask them some questions.
Now, no. One more time.
No. So first of all, please introduce yourself.
My name's Polaris. I'm a drag performer in Tokyo. I'm from the US, from Connecticut.
How long have you been in Tokyo?
I have been in Japan for 11 years and Tokyo for about 9.
How do you identify yourself?
What do you mean? Like gender? I mean, I am mostly trans.
Because I know like the first time we met each other, you were not a trans back then.
Right.
Yeah, so you went through the whole transition in Japan. How was the transition?
Actually really easy. Like, I decided in the beginning to just take it really slowly, step by step, and just kind of changing little things with my friends and people I was comfortable with. And then I got on hormones and started changing my presentation more regularly, and it's been pretty simple.
Was it easy to find resources? For example, like, you need formal, right?
I have enough Japanese that I can do like a Google search and that kind of thing, so that was helpful. There's a few clinics here that offer hormones and information really kind of simply. With the Japanese health insurance, you are supposed to have like a diagnosis and go through all of these waiting periods and stuff, but they have like a law about making informed decisions. So you can get on hormones without a diagnosis as long as the doctor documents that they give you all of the information first, and then it's sort of your own choice.
Are you out to your coworkers, or what's the situation?
A lot of my coworkers follow me on Instagram, so they see all my stories and what I do in my personal life, so they know. But we have a uniform that's the same for any gender.
Right now, like, you have girl's hair, right?
Yeah.
So do you go to work because you're in girl's hair?
I started just like growing my hair out and going kind of step by step. After one of the Obon holidays, I switched to a longer wig, and then the next holiday I switched to a longer wig. I'm a permanent employee, not a contracted employee, so I'm a little bit safer than a lot of other teachers. It's difficult to fire me. So as long as I'm following the general dress code rules, they're not going to say anything.
But do you think like Japan in general is very friendly to trans people?
I don't know about like working culture for Japanese people. I know they tend to put a lot more social pressure on Japanese people than like foreign workers, just because I think they know they can, and the customer base expects Japanese people to sort of follow social rules a little bit more. But I know a lot of companies have what's called a fresh start program, which means if someone wants to transition, they basically have to get transferred to another location and like restart in a different office as their new identity.
Like reset button,
yeah,
basically.
Yeah. Wow. So some people like that. They like the chance to go somewhere where no one knows them and start over. But for some people, I think it's hard. Like, they've worked up the reputation and whatever in the office that they're in, and then they have to go somewhere else.
Yes. I know you personally, so I know that you are very present in the Nichome scene right now.
A little.
What is your best advice for people wanting to find their own community here in Tokyo?
Follow all of the events on Instagram, because typically if like a club or a drag queen or anybody is going to start an event at a bar or club, they're gonna create a new page for the Instagram and then just start going and trying to talk to people.
So just be like very proactive and talk to people at the events and go to the events.
Yeah.
And be present is very important.
I know in the US, if you go out, people are gonna be like, you're new, you're gonna hang out with us and we're gonna like find you a place.
Uh-huh.
But here you definitely have to kind of do your own footwork.
Yeah. Please introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Stephanie from House Montrose. I'm from the capital of Vietnam, Hanoi.
How do you identify yourself?
So I'm a gay man, go by he, him, out of drag, but in drag, go by she.
How long have you been living in Japan?
I've been here since 2013, so this is my 11th year. I lived in Kyushu for 4 years during university time, and then I moved here in 2017.
Is it easy to live as a gay man in Japan?
I would say depending on where you are, because if you are in a big city like Tokyo, Osaka, with a lot of foreigners, a lot of exposure to queer culture, then it's good. But I used to live in Baekdu. There was nothing there. If you're gay, queer, trans, and then if you want to like feel safer, I would say, then you should come to the big city.
A big city like Osaka
or
Tokyo. Exactly. I see.
Like, if you can, then you should find a community of like foreigners as well, because like we all been here, we understand the struggles, and we can support you. But if you go to like, let's say, a rural area with like no foreigners, and then like they have no idea what queerness, and then you present yourself as queer, then it's kind of like, I wouldn't say dangerous, but it would cause troubles to you, because the people, they have no idea what's going on. And then like, you know how Japanese people, they don't really say to your face, but they would do like kind of like a side eye, and then they would be passive aggressive about it. I would not say it's dangerous. I would say it's like inconvenient. Yeah.
So you were talking about finding your own community here, right?
Yes.
So what is the best way to find your own community
in Tokyo? Then we have the Nichome, Shinjuku Nichome. So that's so cliche, like, oh, if you're gay, go to Shinjuku Nichome. But it's really the way. In Shinjuku Nichome, then we have like drag shows, we have go-go parties. So it's a really good place to meet and make connections. It's cliche, but it's the right way to do it.
Are you out at workplace?
Yes. How can I say this? I was out at my previous workplace, and that did not really end well. I smell gay, but there's no reason for me to mention it.
Just to like make an announcement, you know.
I don't
like
need
that.
To make an announcement, because like it doesn't really reflect on my professional career.
So I would say like you're partially in closet here in Japan.
I'm not in closet at all. I have this long hair, and then I have nails, and also like my mannerism and all of that. Like it's very clear that oh, this bitch is gay.
I feel more like, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's almost like you're not in the closet because you're being who you are. But something about naming it might create problems.
Yes, because it happened before. All of my previous jobs, and I was really out, I was open, like, I was talking about like being in a gay relationship, I was talking about doing drag shows and all of that, and yes, I had homophobic incidents, so I'm just like, probably it's best just keep it to myself. Honestly, I think it's easier that way.
Yeah.
And also, like, I work with Japanese teachers, and of course you know Japanese, but they will not ask you like, are you gay? No, that's so rude. They don't do that.
Okay, that brings me to the next question, because you say you have nails, you have long hairs, right?
Yeah.
We also have we always have the image of like Japanese workspace is very strict with like how you look. For example, like a man should have like short hair, no beard, and also like dress up like in suits as well. So
because I work in kindergarten. For kindergarten teaching, it's different, because like it's more relaxing, the environment is a lot more relaxing. If I look presentable, even if I love my long hair, and then I can just tie it back or put it into a bun, make it neat, and then if I have like long nails and I have like nail polish and stuff, as long as they're not like crazy colors like green, purple, then it's fine, because it's still like office friendly in kind of way, you know.
Thank you so much, that's all my questions.
Yes.
The first one is, could you please introduce yourself to everyone home?
I'm Valerie Gitta. I am actually from Germany, and I came here 3 years ago, and now I'm a drag queen.
Before you came here, you weren't a drag queen.
I was a baby queen, but now I'm a queen.
Oh, now you bloom.
Yes.
Alright. Yes. So yeah, what part of the LGBTQ plus community are you?
Difficult. It's a lot of Q, maybe but T. Don't know about that yet. It's like kind of I feel like there's a lot of in between the letters as well.
That brings me to my next question then. How's it like living in Japan as, you know, Q, T in between?
I wouldn't say it's difficult because Japanese people are very kind, or they don't attack you like in Germany. They would attack. Yeah, they would attack me or like say like things at me, but in Japan doesn't happen. It's more systemic issues, not being recognized or acknowledged from society. And whenever I say I'm married, people are, oh, you're married to a woman? Like, no, there's also other people that you can be married to, but Japanese people don't really, they are very ignorant in that sense.
Are you out at work?
I currently don't work in Japan. I don't have a work visa. I'm a student.
Okay.
I'm out at school with my teachers and everybody. Everybody's like Gen Z, so very young. They don't even like think about any like type of discrimination. It's like very natural to them.
And even your teachers?
The teachers, yeah. I mean, I'm a beauty student. I'm a cosmetology student. So there's also gay people in my faculty.
You moved here directly to Tokyo?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. And what do you think about seeing here?
Well, Tokyo is small, you know, almost everybody, it's Nichome, and I feel like it could be bigger. I feel like there's a lot of people holding back, especially people that are not out yet, and it could be a very big community, but I love my community. The voguing scene, I started voguing here, drag is really like fun.
How did you like find, I mean everyone can find Nichome easily,
but
how did you find your community, in the community?
When I came here, I wanted to do drag, so I asked people if I could perform. I mean, you follow people and then you slide into DMs.
You slide into their DMs.
Want to
be friends.
It's easier for people that have more social anxiety to talk than in a bar. Or I feel like if you go to Nichome, there's always groups and it's difficult to like get to those. It's not difficult, but it's like it feels like a wall. It's very a very open and friendly community, so I feel like there's no... I know, no, there's no resentment there.
If you can kindly just introduce to your event, you know, we're seeing the rehearsal today.
I started an event last fall called Queens for a Cause, where every event raises money and awareness for a different environmental conservation effort. Our first event, we raised 60,000 yen for the Environmental Defense Fund. And then our second event last month, we like oversold out and raised twice that, 120,000 yen for the Inuit Circumpolar Convention. They do a lot of work in like protecting Arctic environments. And then now we're preparing for our next event called Oh Honey. Which,
oh Honey,
yes. And we're gonna be donating to the Xerces Foundation. They protect pollinators and various like insect species. The next one is April 13th at Gyoen Rosso in Shinjuku.
I don't know what to say.
Tell people to go.
Okay. So yeah, if you guys remember, Polaris helped me with my drag makeup a couple years ago, and she has been a very supportive friend of mine. Please go watch the event, enjoy yourself, and definitely. If you're new in Tokyo, definitely, I think it's a good chance to meet other people.
Yeah, it's a great community. You can follow us on Instagram at Queens for a Cause Tokyo.
I have a question. I'm not sure if people watching who are not in Japan would want to support, but is there a way if they did?
We actually get a lot of messages from people who can't attend the shows but want to contribute in some way. So we're always looking for different artists to contribute to, like our marketing and advertising stuff. Looking for potential companies to donate. Our first event, we had a partnership with a cosmetics brand that donated some gift boxes. So we did a raffle for those and raised extra money through that effort. We also generally, depends on the charity, but we set up a profile with the charity's web address where you can donate directly to like our account, and it gets lumped in with everything that we donate at the end of the event.
Oh, thank you.
Yay.
All right.